Those people are so ungrateful to be alive. But not you. Not anymore.
Before we jump into the grisly world of Saw, this video is proudly sponsored by Shudder, the channel's first ever sponsorship, and an incredibly fitting one at that. If you're watching my content, then chances are you've got an eye for the world of horror. And well, Shudder has got you sorted. Shudder is the Netflix of horror movies, and should be your go-to site when you need your fill of horror. Shudder is the streaming service with the best selection of horror, thriller, and supernatural movies, series, and originals. From Hollywood favorites and cult classics to original series and critically acclaimed new genre films you won't find anywhere else, streaming uncut and commercial-free right to your favorite devices. Shudder's just finished up its halfway to Halloween month, which was the biggest month in original programming in Shudder history, including season 2 of Creepshow and exclusive movies like The Power, Boys from County Hell, and the 80s horror documentary In Search of Darkness Part 2. May keeps things going with a new original every month, including the mind-melting weirdness of Fried Barry, the splattery sci-fi horror comedy Psycho Goreman, and The Reckoning, the latest from the modern horror master Neil Marshall, the director of The Descent, Dog Soldiers, and episodes of Game of Thrones. Shudder has the largest, fastest-growing human-created selection of thrilling and dangerous entertainment. You'll have unlimited access to stream ad-free on all of your favorite devices, including iPhones, iPads, Apple TV, Xbox One, Amazon Fire TV, Google Chromecast, Roku, and Android devices. I've personally been using Shudder for a while now, and lately I've been enjoying movies such as Possum, House of a Thousand Corpses, Nosferatu, and Audition using the service. I'll even be using the service to watch the movie I'll be covering in next week's video. With their own unique exclusive movies and shows, with genres ranging from supernatural, creature features, psychological thrillers, revenge, crime and mystery, comedy, sci-fi, and cult classics. You really can't go wrong with what Shudder has to offer. So get started streaming now from $5.99 a month or $56.99 a year. Shudder's expertly curated collection includes must-see titles like Color Out of Space, Host, the Mortuary Collections, plus all of the best horror documentaries and the hit Creepshow TV series from executive producer Greg Nicotero of The Walking Dead. To try Shudder free for 30 days, go to shudder.com, that is shudder.com, and use promo code BIGWILL. Saw is a franchise which started out with an interesting enough concept, enough to be genuinely thought-provoking and engaging. But as the years went on, the realization of its money-making capabilities grew, causing the franchise to suffer from a bloat, where you'd go into each movie pretty confident in knowing exactly what you were going to get out of it. Dark, sadistic, disturbing traps, and some sort of a twist at the end. But in my opinion, right at the very beginning is where Saw shines the brightest. The movie begins with a man named Adam waking up submerged in a bathtub with a locked chain around his ankle. As he's shouting out for help, confused and disorientated about what's happening, he discovers that he's in a dark, dirty room. Adam realizes that he's not in the room alone. There's another man in there, a surgeon named Lawrence, who is also chained up but on the other side of the room. After Lawrence manages to find the light switch, they discover what appears to be a dead man lying on the floor in the middle of the room with a self-inflicted gunshot wound to the head, with them both coming to the realization that there's clearly no obvious or easy way out of this situation. They both start trying to remember what it is that could have possibly led them to ending up in this situation. Adam discovers a tape recording in his pocket, and Lawrence also finds a tape, along with a single bullet and a key. It becomes apparent to the viewer, as well as them, that this clearly isn't some sort of random kidnapping. There's something going on here. They're going to need to figure out what's going on and how to escape based off what little clues they've been given. After noticing the corpse in the middle of the room is holding a tape recorder, Adam manages to get a hold of it to play his tape. A dark, creepy, ominous voice proceeds to ask Adam if he's willing to die in this room today. After not exactly being told anything really useful, he also plays Lawrence's tape, where they then both discover that the man on the tape is only giving them one way out of the room. Lawrence has to kill Adam, and he's only got until 6 o'clock to do it. Otherwise, his wife and daughter will be killed, and he'll be left to rot in the room forever. With them both coming to the conclusion that they're two pawns in some sort of twisted game of life and death, they both start looking around, trying to figure out some clues. Adam discovers that there's two saws hidden in the top of a toilet, and after he breaks his trying to cut through the chains, the horrible realization starts to sink in. These saws aren't for cutting through the chains, they're for cutting through their legs. With this looking more and more like some sort of sick and twisted game, Lawrence begins to remember the fact that he might actually know who's behind this. He explains to Adam that he was a suspect in multiple murders because of some planted evidence, where someone had been kidnapping people and forcing them to face the ultimate ultimatum, life or death. The people were placed in different situations, but much like the one they're currently faced with, where they need to complete a difficult task within a certain time frame, or they'd be brutally and savagely killed for it. One man was forced to crawl through feet of bunched up razor wire in order to free himself, and another man was locked in a room, covered in a flammable substance, and forced to try and unlock a safe by figuring out the code, but using a lit candle as his only light source. Lawrence explains that the police have dubbed him the Jigsaw Killer, because he carves a jigsaw piece into their flesh after they die. But the thing is about this killer is that he doesn't actually directly murder anyone. Instead, finding sadistic and disturbing ways for them to either kill themselves or to get free. So at this point, the odds of figuring a way out of this situation without following Jigsaw's plan is little to none. They've been placed in a situation completely out of their control, where they're going to need to make hard decisions if any of them want to survive, including murder. We see through a flashback of Lawrence in the police station, hearing a survivor of one of Jigsaw's sadistic traps, explaining to the police what situation she was forced into and what she had to do in order to survive. She explains that she had a bear trap device attached to her face, and a creepy puppet appeared on the TV screen, explaining to her that she only has a limited time to try and retrieve a key to unlock the device, before it then activates, forcefully ripping her jaw from her face. But the key she needs in order to remove the device is placed inside the stomach of an incapacitated man in the corner of the room. He's lying there, unable to move as he's forcefully been given an overdose. And well, as the woman is clearly still alive, that means she cut this man's insides open, dug around inside his guts, and found the key to free herself. This knowledge helps set in the fact to Lawrence and Adam that they're definitely not getting out of this situation easily. These events are very much real, and it's undoubtedly going to end in at least one unavoidable death. The movie doesn't just cover the events of a trapped Adam and Lawrence. We also see one of Lawrence's co-workers named Zepp has broken into Lawrence's home when he isn't there and has kidnapped his wife and daughter, with Zepp presumably being the one who will kill them both if Lawrence doesn't manage to kill Adam before 6 o'clock rolls around. As well as the movie following his co-worker, there's also a subplot following two cops investigating Jigsaw sometime in the past. They manage to narrow down his location and find his hideout using the video footage from the puppet. When they enter the location, they uncover a miniature display of the situation Lawrence and Adam will later be held in, proving to the audience that these actions are well thought out in advance, even to the point of creating a sculpture depicting the soon-to-be events. As well as discovering that, the detectives also find the puppet used in the videos alongside a captive man restrained to a chair with two drills pointing towards his temple. Jigsaw returns to the hideout, unaware of the police officers, and is then confronted by them. He makes a break for it, but not before activating the trap and slashing open the throat of one of the officers. As the injured officer stumbles his way after Jigsaw and his colleague, the one who engaged in a pursuit walks right into a booby trap, a tripwire which fires multiple shotguns directly into the victim's head. With one officer well and truly dead, and the other one in the process of dying, Jigsaw is able to escape from them both. But this proves to the audience that even though Jigsaw is known for putting his victims in situations where they will very likely end up dead, even though he isn't the one to directly kill them, he also has no problem in actually directly murdering people either. Sure, he didn't pull the trigger on those shotguns into that police officer, but he knowingly lured him into that trap. And even though the officer who got slashed ended up surviving, there's no way Jigsaw knew he would survive that, and no way that you could convince anyone that that clearly wasn't an attempted murder. He's a man who appears to be living in his own sick and twisted fantasy world, where he sees himself as some sort of alternate Grim Reaper, where he believes he's right in choosing to put people in these horrific life and death situations, masquerading his actions as teaching them a lesson about the value of life. But when it comes down to it, he's nothing more than a killer. Back with Lawrence and Adam, they discover a box hidden within the wall. After they unlock the box, using the key that Lawrence found in his pocket earlier, they discover a cell phone that can only receive calls, two cigarettes, and a note explaining to Lawrence that he doesn't need a gun to kill Adam. Lawrence comes to the conclusion that there's poison in the blood of the dead corpse in the middle of the room, based off what the note has told him and the cryptic tape recordings from earlier. So after turning out the lights, so whoever is obviously watching them can't see what they're up to, he whispers to Adam his plan to make it look like he's soaking the cigarette tip in the poison blood, which he would then give to an unknowing Adam to smoke and then die. After turning on the lights, he dips the cigarette, but throws the second untouched one to Adam, where then Adam begins to play dead. However, the person orchestrating this whole sick fantasy decides to electrocute Adam somehow, causing him to react in pain, therefore proving that he was indeed faking it. With the pair running out of ideas on how to escape this situation, the clock reaches 6 o'clock, and Adam is indeed still alive. Zepp makes a call to Lawrence and forces his wife at gunpoint to tell him he's failed. After hearing this and believing his wife and daughter are about to be killed, he realizes he really only has one way of saving them, to do exactly what he was ordered to do. Without an ounce of hesitation, he reaches for the saw and then begins to slice back and forth through his own ankle. Once he's cut through the bone and the other side, he crawls to the gun in the middle of the room, loads it with the one sole bullet, aims it at Adam, and pulls the trigger. Zepp then enters the room behind him, claiming that he's too late and that he didn't do it in time. But all of a sudden, Adam jumps up after only being shot in the shoulder, grabs a loose piece of the wall, and savagely bashes Zepp's brains in with it. With Adam actually still being alive, and Lawrence now being free from the chains, Lawrence explains to Adam that he's going to go and crawl off to get some help. Once Adam is alone with the two corpses, Zepp, the guy he just killed, and the dead guy who's been there from the very beginning, he begins to rummage through Zepp's pockets, in hopes of at least finding a key or something that could help him. Then he discovers that Zepp has a tape on him. After playing the tape, he learns that Zepp actually wasn't an outright bad guy. Jigsaw had also got to him and had injected him with a slow-acting poison, giving him the ultimatum of doing exactly what he's told in order to get the antidote, or to let the poison take over his body and kill him, making it clear that Zepp actually wasn't the bad guy all along. He was once again another one of Jigsaw's unfortunate victims, another pawn in his disgustingly brutal game of life and death. Just as Adam is realizing this, the original dead guy, the one who's been there from the very beginning with a hole in his head, stands up, removes a prosthetic from his head, and tells Adam the key to his chains have been in the bathtub this whole time, and in doing so, revealing that this man here is actually Jigsaw. He turns the lights off, walks over to the main door, says game over, and slams the door shut, leaving Adam to presumably rot in this pitch black, damp, decrepit room. And then the movie ends. The thing is about Saw is that it sets up a genuinely interesting premise and ends in a way that leaves you with more questions than you started with. It's a smartly done, interesting story, which poses the question of, how far are you willing to go to save your own life? And what are you willing to do in the process? It's a look into the human psyche, which forces these people to tap into some of their most primal instincts, survival. Because if you corner a human and don't really give them much of a choice, the chances are they'll do just about anything to survive. And if that means killing someone else in the process, like having to burrow through the insides of a living man in order to find a key, or shoot someone you've just spent hours getting to know, well then so be it. Unlike the later entries in the series, it hasn't got a strong reliance on gore or torture. Sure, it does have those elements, that sort of thing is right at home in a movie like this, But that isn't the main draw of this movie. It's got far more to offer than simply watch this guy desperately try his hardest to save himself before dying a horrifically brutal death. That's the direction that later entries would start steering towards. And I guess when you start narrowly approaching 10 entries in a series, you've probably not got much else to go on. But who knows? Perhaps one day, we'll delve into the rest of the series and uncover the origins behind Jigsaw's sick and twisted game of life and death. Before I wrap things up, I just wanted to say a big thank you to my patrons. Thank you to Dom, Bort, Hunters263, and Caleb Barnaby. YouTube's not exactly a fan of this type of content, so most of my videos get limited monetization, which means I basically get next to nothing for each one I put out. So it's super inspiring to me that there's actually people out there willing to financially help the channel grow. So thank you guys. The channel's also got a Discord as well, so if you want to discuss this movie or other movies, there's a place where like-minded individuals can come together and do that. Also, if you wanted to leave a movie recommendation, that'd probably be the best place to do it. So once again, thank you so much to my patrons, and thank you to everyone else for watching.